where Churchill admitted the Secretary of State for Air on that very day, the 7th of June, 1942, saying he'd heard good reports of progress. And how he got good reports, I don't know, but there you are, because there was nothing good about it. But when he heard of the crash, he demanded to see us. And so a few weeks later, Dee, who was our division leader, he and I were summoned to Downing Street to meet Churchill, and he'd assembled in the cabinet room the whole galaxy of cabinet ministers, the Secretary of State for Air, the Chief of Bomber Command, the deputy, his advisor, Charwell, and Shondland, who was the head of EMI, who had the contract for making 200 equipments. And it was really an extraordinary meeting. He was told what had happened, and he repeated his demand that he must have two squadrons by October to light up the target. And Shondland said, "Prime Minister, even if we had all the details, we couldn't possibly make 200 equipments by October." And Churchill got very angry. He said, "Look here, we don't have objections in this room." And then I had the misfortune to say, "Prime Minister, we have just lost our bomber with the only equipment in it." And he turned to me and he said, "Young man," he said, "you just lost bomber. Don't you realise last night we lost 30 over Cologne and you've just lost one? You go into that anteroom and don't come out until you tell us how you're going to do it." And I could see his unlit cigar being whipped over his shoulder into the place, into the shelf behind him. And that was Churchill. And he, so he was really asking for the impossible. He said, "Don't you realise our only means of hitting the enemy?" Of course, we were isolated. We just lost Singapore, and the situation really did seem hopeless. Well, what happened then? We had a frantic weekend of going around various firms, and Churchill then appointed Renwick. He wrote to the Secretary of State, said he wanted to put a superior person in charge of this development who would report directly to him. And he said he heard good reports from a man called Renwick, who was a chairman of the London Electricity Board, I think. So that's how we came in touch with Sir Robert Renwick. He later became Lord Renwick. And by that means, we really did have immediate contact with the Prime Minister. Now, Renwick, he appointed a person we called a winger, a Canadian called Sayers. And if anything went wrong, and or if we wanted anything and Sayers couldn't put it right or couldn't get the thing we wanted, he'd report to Renwick, and Renwick would report immediately to Churchill. That's the sort of a priority we lived under in those days. And I can tell you, it was pretty unpleasant. At the same time, Bomber Command reorganized itself. I mean, CNC Bomber Harris was at the meeting, and Saumby, his deputy, and they scarcely said a word. The situation was quite dramatic because General Ismay, who was the secretary, kept coming in and being summoned by Churchill. And he came in and said, "Prime Minister, the cabinet are waiting outside." And he said, "Tell them to wait." You know, that sort of attitude. Anyhow, I must say, he made a tremendous impression on me. And he appointed Renwick. And that situation was thereafter. Nearly every day, Renwick would phone me. And he'd say, "Any news, any problems?" And that's the sort of life we lived.